Dear colleagues, it is my pleasure to continue the lupus nephritis presentations, and today I'm going to focus on the use of immunosuppressive therapies for controlling lupus nephritis. I'm going to discuss these following corners: principles of treatment, guidelines for the use of immunosuppressive drugs, and I'll present the KDIGO guidelines in a summary, and then the biological therapy, the use of calcineurin inhibitors in the management of lupus nephritis, a few slides and a hint on plasmapheresis usage, IVIGenic stem cells, then how to monitor drugs, special situation, and I'll end with the concluding remarks. Let us to start with the principles of the use of immunosuppressive therapies for treatment of lupus nephritis. The aims and the strategy is to start as early as possible and to be aggressive enough to obtain complete remission and able to prevent renal flare, delaying or preventing progression to indecision and disease, and the most important is the wise use of immunosuppressive therapy. Yes, would like to control lupus nephritis, but in the same moment, the same importance is to avoid over immunosuppressive or the usage of immunosuppressive drugs where there are occasions. Those who don't like to have a patient with aggressive infection or malignancy. There are two phases of therapeutics regarding the use of immunosuppressive drugs. Induction phase, this is a phase of intensive immunosuppressive therapies, and the aim of this induction phase is to achieve remission. And then followed by maintenance phase to prevent relapse, prevent progression to indecision and disease, and to prevent patient death. So these are the rationale and the phases of lupus nephritis treatment by immunosuppressive therapy. We have the KDIGO guidelines that were published in 2012 regarding the treatment of lupus nephritis. If you are dealing with a pathology of class 1, the guidelines suggest that patients with class 1 lupus nephritis be treated as dictated by the extrarenal clinical manifestations of lupus. Again, the evidence is not strong, it's suggestion based on a very weak evidence from literature. And if we are dealing with class 6 lupus nephritis, advanced sclerosing lupus nephritis, the guidelines recommended that patients with class 6 lupus nephritis be treated with corticosteroid and immunosuppressive only as dictated by the extrarenal manifestations of systemic lupus. Again, the evidence is weak, but it is very rational, because if there are no manifestations except renal failure and we have advanced sclerosis, it means that this is a chronic renal failure, so it is better to release the patient from immunosuppressive treatment and not to start this line of therapy, because the patient may need in the future renal transplantation and to preserve immune suppression for the transplantation. But if the patient suffers from extrarenal manifestation that necessitate immunosuppressive therapies, the immunosuppressive therapies are given because of extrarenal manifestation. Regarding class 2, which is mesangial proliferative lupus nephritis, treat patients with class 2 and proteinuria less than 1 gram as dictated by extrarenal clinical manifestation as mentioned in the class 1. But if the proteinuria exceed 3 gram per day, the patient may be treated with corticosteroids or calcineurin inhibitors as described for minimal change disease. And this is again the weak evidence. Regarding lupus podocytopathy that I discussed in the sector of diagnosis, how to diagnose by the four criteria that I mentioned in the diagnosis sector, please review the first tape of diagnosis to know how we diagnose lupus podocytopathy. And the treatment for lupus podocytopathy is steroids, and then to assess response, usually the response is complete remission 76%, partial remission in 18%, and no response in 6%. And this is the the rest of the data according to the type of lupus podocytopathy. Is it minimal change, mesangial proliferative, or focal and segmental glomerulosclerosis? So in lupus podocytopathy, we start with steroids. If no response, we can add calcineurin inhibitors, as I'll show later. Regarding class 3 and 4, which are the classes of proliferative lupus nephritis, the guidelines show that the treatment is corticosteroid plus cyclophosphamide or MMF. And this is the evidence for corticosteroids 1A, recommendation based on strong level of evidence and recommendation to give either cyclophosphamide or MMF, recommendation based on moderate evidence. So the treatment of for class 3 or class 4 is to start combined corticosteroid and cyclophosphamide or MMF. And I think if the guidelines will be updated, they will shift to corticosteroid plus MMF or cyclophosphamide, as proven from studies, different studies, that MMF is equipotent like cyclophosphamide and with less side effects. So this is regarding the maintenance, the initiation phase, and the maintenance phase is the same combination therapy, but was started with continuing with low dose steroid, prednisolone is then 10 milligram per day, or equal 10 milligram per day, and either using azathioprine or MMF, azathioprine in the dose 1.5 to 1.5 milligram per kg per day, or MMF 1 to 2 gram per day. Again, if the guidelines will be updated, you will find a shift into low dose prednisolone plus MMF or azathioprine. And the level of evidence is recommendation based on moderate evidence of research. If we have class 5 lupus nephritis, which is the membranous lupus nephritis, the guidelines recommend that patients with class 5 lupus nephritis with normal kidney function and non-nephrotic range proteinuria be treated with antiproteinuric and antihypertensive medications and only receive corticosteroid and immune suppressive as dictated by the extrarenal manifestation of systemic lupus. Again, the evidence is suggestion based on weak evidence. And then there is a suggestion that patients with pure class 5 and persistent nephrotic proteinuria be treated with corticosteroids plus an additional immune suppressive agents, either cyclophosphamide or calcineurin inhibitors or MMF or azathioprine. And you can look at the evidence between brackets to know all of them are suggestion based on weak or very weak evidence of research. Again, this is a recent study showing immunosuppressive treatment for pure membranous lupus in Hispanic population, and you can look at the difference combination of complete remission, partial or no response. And the most important points that I want to add is the presence of anti-malarial drug chloroquine increases the complete remission in pure membranous nephropathy. Again, I'm stressing upon the value of the use of anti-malarial drug. So the standard of care, according to this review article, is to start prednisone 1 milligram per kg per day. The maximum is 80 milligram per day to be tapered over weeks. In severe proliferative disease, consider intravenous methylbred 0.25 quarter a gram to 1 gram per day for 1 to 3 days before starting oral corticosteroids plus either cyclophosphamide or mycophenolate mefotel. The dose of cyclophosphamide, the old regimen was NIH regimen, which was 0.5 to 1 gram per square meter monthly for 60 doses. And the more recent is Eurolupus low dose protocol, 500 milligram every 2 weeks for 60 doses only, or using oral regimen as shown in the slide. And the using mycophenolate mofetil, 2 to 3 gram per day for 6 months. So this is the regimen of induction to be followed by maintenance therapy. The duration of induction is ranged between 3 months to 1 year according to the clinical and the pathological manifestation, then followed by maintenance. What is the maintenance? It's low dose prednisolone and either MMF, and MMF in this study, ALMS study, is superior to azacitidine. But in the maintain trial, the azacitidine is equivalent to MMF. So do you like to use MMF or azacitidine? I look at these variations in the publications as a mercy, because we can use azacitidine if there is no availability of MMF, in the if there is no support from insurance, and if there is intolerability because of side effects of MMF regarding diarrhea, etc., or for pregnant ladies, because MMF shouldn't be used for pregnant ladies. So we can use either of them, but the tendency from the research is toward the superiority of MMF to others, cerebrin. I want just to confirm the title of this article is sustained remission in lupus nephritis is still a hard road ahead. It's very difficult to be sure that everything is fine and lupus nephritis is completely eradicated, because some reports that were published in the rheumatology journals showed that even relapse may occur even after 15 years of complete remission. So the question, when should we discontinue immune suppressive drugs in proliferative lupus nephritis? This is a very difficult question. However, the tradition is to continue immune suppression for a year after induction to be sure that everything is solidified. And this is according to the KDIGO guidelines. However, sometimes it's very difficult to completely discontinue immune suppressive therapy. However, from the practical point, from our practice, if we succeed in inducing full remission and followed by low dose combined therapy for maintenance for a year, and there is no relapse, no flare, we can start this, withdrawal of immune suppressive drugs. But if there is any activity, we can continue even for years and years. So it is a very difficult question to be answered. Regarding biological therapies, again, if we review the pathogenetic mechanisms, as I mentioned in the diagnosis tape, as I mentioned, we have the abundance of apoptosis, so we have anti-tweak. And then if you look to the immune response, there is, if this is the antigen-presenting cells and this is the T cells, so the drugs either to target B cells or target the cells or target the response process, plasma cell, or the antibodies by removal of antibodies and complement activation by anti-complement therapy. If we focus on B cells, we have an important class of therapeutics, of biological therapies, which is anti-CD20. And CD20 include rituximab, ocrelizumab, obinutuzumab. All these are drugs targeting CD20. The question, what about rituximab? Because rituximab is very famous and is used in many centers, especially in refractory cases. What about the randomized controlled trials in treating lupus nephritis with rituximab? The randomized controlled trials, Explorer and the Lunar trials, were negative, and rituximab was comparable to the didn't add a beneficial effect in lupus nephritis treatment, and it is a very costly drug. Some question regarding this point: why rituximab didn't succeed in randomized controlled trial? There are many theories. One of these theories is rituximab, yes, it is a drug, anti-CD20 drug, but it depletes effectively the peripheral blood B cells, but it doesn't deplete the interstitial B lymphocytes. So this one, so B lymphocytes inside the kidney tissues and the lymphoid tissues are persistent and not amenable for depletion by the use of rituximab. Point two, after rituximab therapy, plus B lymphocyte stimulating factor increases, and this will stimulate B cells. So these are within the, so this is why obinutuzumab is currently on a clinical trial, because obinutuzumab deplete both peripheral B cells and interstitial B cells. And there is another trial to use belimumab, which is anti-BLyS monoclonal antibodies, after rituximab to avoid stimulation of B cells. Regarding the activation of B cell, we have two pathways, BLyS and IBRIL. Anti-BLyS, which is belimumab, which is human monoclonal antibody, and this is the only monoclonal antibody that has FDA approval for the management of lupus patients, and here it targets BLyS but doesn't target IBRIL. The Atacept targets both BLyS and IBRIL, and we are waiting the results of Atacept. Regarding the adhesion molecules, because I mentioned that the antigen is presented to the C receptors, and we should have adhesion molecules to strengthen the response. So we have B7, CD25, and we have here abatacept, which is blocking this adhesion molecules, and CD40 ligand blocks the CD40 ligand CD40 adhesion molecules. So this is regarding the adhesion molecules. Plasma cell, we have proteasome inhibitors like bortezomib, antibodies, plasma exchange, complement 5 activation, complement 5 eculizumab, and here in the immune response we have calcineurin inhibitors that inhibits the action of calcineurin, so it dephosphorylates nuclear factor of activated T cells, and this will lead to decreasing release of interleukin 2. So this is a map for the monoclonal antibodies. If we look at this table that showed the completed and terminated clinical trials and the active clinical trials, if you look here, all these are completed and terminated. One important point is this lacinamide. Lacinamide inhibit inflammation, so it targets all inflammation, and its results in phase 2 is encouraging. If we look at the active clinical trials, this drug targets interferon alpha, so this is a phase 2 and it's still recruiting a patient. Belimumab, it's plus, and phase 3 recruitment closed, and we are waiting the result. Ixazomib, it is active against the plasma cell, still phase 1 recruiting. Obinutuzumab, it's active against CD20, and as I mentioned, it's active against the blood and in the tissues. Rituximab, CD20 steroid reduced. Rituximab, belimumab, as I mentioned before, or voclosporin. So a lot of trials are still ongoing, and we are waiting a lot of research to prove or disprove the role of biological therapy in the management of lupus nephritis. And if you look at this figure, it shows a lot of monoclonal antibodies. So this is for anti-CD20, rituximab, ocrelizumab, ofatumumab. All these are anti-CD20, and CD22, ibrutinib, but it is associated with high level of infection. Anti-CD74, anti-atacept, as I mentioned before. Here, alemtuzumab, which is campus against anti-CD25. All these are targets for molecules. If you look at the mesangial cell inflammation, etc. So a lot of monoclonal antibodies can be tested in management of autoimmunity. Regarding the use of calcineurin inhibitors in lupus nephritis, in proliferative lupus nephritis, this is one of the important trials that introduced the tacrolimus for the management armamentarium of lupus nephritis, because this is a randomized control trial, included 362 patients, but the problem is it's open label trial to assess the efficacy, and this is the open label trial, and in China alone. but it included large number of lupus nephritis. And it showed that the use of multi-target therapy, steroid, tacrolimus and MMF, is superior to steroid and cyclophosphamide. Because at starting of the study, IV cyclophosphamide was the gold standard. So the multi-target therapy proved the role of calcium inhibitors. In the current issue of nephrology and dialysis transplant, in the issue of October this month, you will find the polar views of the use of calcineurin inhibitors in management of lupus nephritis. Polar views means some defending, some opinions against, and then the moderator view. And this is I am convinced by this data. There are many items with the use of calcineurin inhibitors, and some items are against. What with calcineurin inhibitor is this class of drugs is effective in management of lupus nephritis and potentially safe. So for efficacy, there is a higher complete remission rate than cyclophosphamide, shorter median time to remission, a stronger antiproteinuric effect, decreased activity index, improvement in lupus serology, avoidance of relapse. All these are advantages for the use of these drugs from the efficacy point of view. And for the safety points of view, they are associated with fewer serious adverse events in comparison to cyclophosphamide, lower infection rates, lower leukopenia, lower gastrointestinal disorders, fewer menstrual disorders, less liver dysfunction in comparison to the other drugs. But if you look to the cons, no improvement in estimated GFR and increasing in chronicity indices. And more new onset hypertension, hyperglycemia, nephrotoxicity, because these are the most common side effects of calcineurin inhibitors and other, including tremors, alopecia for tacrolimus, hirsutism for cyclosporin. So if we weigh the balance between pro and cons, we can select the best timing and the best patient for the use of calcineurin inhibitors in peripheral lupus. Sometimes we use them as added treatment in a triple protocol like multi-target therapy. Again, this is a study showing that relative efficacy and safety of tacrolimus, mycophenolic mofetil and cyclophosphamide as induction therapy for lupus nephritis by following the network meta-analysis of randomized controlled trials. So this is indirect comparison because in randomized controlled trial we compare A versus C. But in network meta-analysis, we can make indirect comparison. So if we look at this indirect comparison by network meta-analysis, you will find superiority in efficacy and safety to tacrolimus in comparison to other drugs. Regarding plasmapheresis and IVIG, this one of the important and very recent study that assessed double filtration plasmapheresis combined with methylprednisolone to treat diffuse borrelative lupus nephritis, but the study included a few number of patients, just 24 patients in a randomized controlled trial. If you read the end result, is there is no significant difference between the two arms, but if you read the details, you'll find the group of patients treated with plasmapheresis, the use of immune suppression was significantly lower in intensity in comparison to the control group, and the second importance is the time to remission is shorter. So it seems that there are some advantages for the use of plasmapheresis, but up to this moment, we are not convinced as physician dealing with lupus nephritis to add plasmapheresis to the front of management of lupus nephritis, and we need indications like thrombotic microangiopathy, or presence of severe vasculitis or antiphospholipid syndrome. And if you look here, the guidelines suggest that patients with systemic lupus and thrombotic thrombocytopenic purpura receive plasma exchange as for patients with thrombocytopenic purpura without systemic lupus. Regarding the IVIG, although it is beneficial in the severe case, refractory case of lupus nephritis, but we like to use it whenever there are in suspicion or we are afraid of infection, so we use IVIG for treatment of lupus nephritis in these situations. Stem cell therapy, still there are few reports from here and there showing the some efficacy of stem cell, but it's still debated because if you use it, the relapse may occur. So this is one of the studies showing the umbilical cord mesenchymal stem cell transplantation in active and refractory systemic lupus erythematosus, a multi-center clinical study. And as I mentioned, still we are not so convinced by the use of stem cell therapy in lupus nephritis. How to monitor immune suppressive drugs by following the for glucocorticoid glucose monitoring, for hydroxychloroquine ophthalmology monitoring, CBC, azathioprine CBC, and platelet function, serum creatinine, liver function tests, cyclophosphamide CBC, and screening for liver function tests, and the methotrexate liver function test CBC. So we are monitoring the clinical effect of the drug and laboratory effect of the drug, mycophenolate mofetil CBC, liver function, serum creatinine, etc. And again, the evidence is not so strong. But what I want to discuss with you is, do we recommend testing for MMF level 2D or not 2D therapeutic drug monitoring, yes or no? 1 year ago, I was not convinced by the MMF because I reviewed the studies in transplantation and I found that studies stressed on the MMF level versus no MMF level, there was no difference. However, currently and after reading further in this topic, I am a little bit convinced by the superiority of doing the TDM by requesting the level for MMF. Why? Because I am not totally convinced by monitoring by side effects, by occurrence of diarrhea or leukopenia. But the major concern is the availability. So if the level is available, I'm toward the requesting the level for MMF, because sometimes you find a patient to be treated with 0.5 gram and other to be treated with 3 gram. So we don't know. So it's better if it's available to be followed. Again, when we treat the patients, we should concentrate on the patient and the patient preferences and the occurrence of side effects, especially side effects regarding body image and self-image with the use of medication. And here, this is one of the studies showing that all these are very important. And hydroxychloroquine may reduce risk of incident diabetes mellitus in lupus patients in a dose-dependent manner. So if there is no contraindication for hydroxychloroquine, I stressed on its use and the recommendation stressed upon its use in all classes of lupus nephritis. And this is one of the messages. Use hydroxychloroquine, it associated with reduced incident diabetes mellitus risk in a dose-dependent manner in systemic lupus erythematosus. And glucocorticoid-associated diabetes mellitus in SLE patients can be ameliorated by concomitant use of hydroxychloroquine. This is another still experimental in the basic research, because nuclear factor erythroid-2-related factor is a critical target for treatment of glucocorticoid-resistant lupus nephritis. So in near future, we may have drug focusing this pathway. This is a very important, because if you look here, you'll find this is MRI criteria of PRESS. What's meant by PRESS? This posterior reversible encephalopathy syndrome. And here I want to just discuss with you, according to the discussion in this case report, is it due to lupus nephritis or the use of drug? And the drug that was used in this case was rituximab, so we should be careful about that. And this is another monoclonal antibody against TNF that may be used in the rheumatoid arthritis. And this is golimumab, which is a human monoclonal antibody. However, this is a case report showing that this drug even may lead to lupus nephritis. So we should deal with new biological therapies by great caution, because not every new is good. Pregnancy and patients with pre-existing lupus nephritis this 15 year of experience at single center in Korea, pregnancy is a very alarming, and we advise patients with active lupus nephritis to avoid pregnancy, because pregnancy increases the activity of lupus nephritis and increases the flare. And thus, the predictors, this study showed the predictors for renal flare among pregnancies with systemic lupus erythematosus, the presence of active disease, and the presence of pre-existing lupus nephritis, and the presence of lower creatinine or lower higher creatinine or lower GFR are associated by flare. So it is better to have the disease well controlled and the patient is maintained on no immunosuppression or a very low level of immunosuppressive drugs to allow the ladies for pregnancy. However, the decision of termination of pregnancy is not ours. We should discuss with the obstetrician and the patients, and at the end of the day, the decision is to the wife and the family. Another point here in this study, if we succeed to induce remission within a short period, within 6 months after delivery, this is associated with better long-term outcome. Pregnancies in women receiving renal transplant, if the patient with lupus nephritis suffered from end-stage kidney disease and managed with renal transplantation, occurrence of pregnancy after transplantation may increase lupus nephritis flare. This is a very interesting 11 cases for whom renal biopsy was carried out and recommended according to the clinical situation. And this study raises a very important question that I discussed in the diagnosis sector regarding the indications and recommendation of doing a biopsy in pregnancy. And as I mentioned, it's better to avoid biopsy after 28 weeks of gestation, and it's better to be trained, the person who will do biopsy, to be trained on biopsy in a pregnancy, and if there is contraindication, the biopsy shouldn't be done, and to be done carefully. And as I mentioned the indication in the first sector, please review the indication in the first half. Regarding termination of pregnancy, it's better to discuss with the patients. And the most important point is to plan for pregnancy instead of dealing with pregnant lady with lupus nephritis. However, if you will be confronted by a lady who comes to you with pregnancy and the lupus is still active, we monitor the disease and monitor the fetus and change the immunosuppressive drugs to cope with pregnancy, so steroid and other sovereign can be used in pregnancy, and we stop unnecessary or contraindicated medication and to follow up meticulously the patients. Sometimes it is advisable to terminate pregnancy, especially if there is a severe flare, to do biopsy to characterize and to give the aggressive immunosuppressive drugs in these situations, because pregnancy will oblige us to avoid some necessary medication. So according to the clinical manifestation, according to the activity of lupus nephritis and the activity of systemic lupus erythematosus, we decide, but there is again no solid base. We should discuss with the patients, we should be wise in our approach and to calculate pro and cons of continuation or termination of pregnancy. To conclude, yes, immunosuppressive treatment is very important in lupus nephritis, because as I mentioned in the pathogenesis, lupus nephritis means autoimmunity and inflammation, so immunosuppression in the active lupus nephritis is mandatory. However, we should know by heart the wise approach for the using immunosuppressive drugs. And I recommend reading these two articles. This is a systematic review, comparative effectiveness of immunosuppressive drugs and corticosteroid for lupus nephritis, a systematic review and network meta-analysis, and this is the risk of serious infection with immunosuppressive drugs and glucocorticoid for lupus nephritis, again a systematic review and network meta-analysis. They are very nice because they discuss the combinations of drugs, of immunosuppressive drugs, and the complications. And this is a very wise algorithm of treatment. Here the algorithm is based upon many issues. Ethnicity, so if we are dealing with African American or Hispanic, as I mentioned, the diagnosis sector, these ethnicities are associated with worse outcomes. So induction with MMF preferred to cyclo فوسفامايد. Maintenance therapy, because here I want to stress upon the cyclophosphamide is superior in white women and the MMF is superior in black women. And this is the maintenance protocol. MMF is referred to azathioprine unless pregnancy is planned. In white European, induction with MMF or cyclophosphamide. MMF fertility is a major issue. Low dose cyclophosphamide for mild disease and maintenance with MMF or other as a pregnancy is planned. MMF for 3 years should follow successful MMF induction. So all these are very important. The Asian induction was MMF tech because multi-target therapy that I mentioned that was conducted in China. MMF tech cyclophosphamide or MMF tacrolimus. MMF for tech if fertility is a major issue and maintenance with these drugs, and be careful if there is MMF should follow successful MMF induction. MMF should be used for 2 years before switching to other cyclophosphamide. So for every ethnicity, we can deal with special protocol. And if you are dealing with a patient with a female with poor adherence or a patient with poor adherence, here the induction by intravenous cyclophosphamide because you will be sure that the patient received the treatment. According to disease characteristic, if you are dealing with proliferative, refractory, or predominantly chronic lesion, if you are dealing with predominant chronic lesion, here induction and minimal immunosuppressive renal suppressive therapy, renal protection and CKD management is better than giving aggressive immune suppression because, as I mentioned, you will be faced by complication of immune suppressive drugs. In refractory lupus, induction switch to other agents like this and using rituximab, and as you see, this is a strategy for treatment and maintenance of lupus nephritis in according to the ethnicity, anticipated poor adherence of the patients, and disease characteristics. Up to this moment, we are waiting a lot of research for refinement of the use of immunosuppressive drugs in lupus nephritis and to reach the best gold standard protocol. So we are waiting, as Professor Dennis Gilling stated, the clinical trial is the fundamental tool of medicine. We are waiting a strong and wise studies to help us in the management of lupus nephritis. If you would like to read, I refer to these publications, and this is toward new avenues in the management of lupus nephritis, columnar nephritis, very important and to be read. And this is the current issue of the JASN showing the current and emerging therapy for lupus nephritis, and these are other two articles. And at the end of my presentation, I'll be happy to receive your questions in my email. Thank you very much for your attention, and goodbye.